Assalamu alaikum, dear students. I am Safir Hussain, and this is your second lecture for your subject History of English Literature 1. And today we shall talk about Anglo-Saxon literature. We have discussed about the political history of the English nation and their beginnings, where had they come from, and we have talked a little about the political history of English nation from their beginnings to the end of Anglo-Saxon period. Today we shall see the literature of that period. So first of all, Anglo-Saxon period is a part of the medieval periods in the history of English race or nation. The medieval period ranges from 670 AD till 1500 AD, and medieval period is a long period, and this period has been further divided into two periods. The first period, which of the literature of which we would be studying, is the Anglo-Saxon period, which ranges from 670 AD till 1066, or roughly 1100 AD. And after 1100 AD, when the kingship or reign of William the Conqueror begins, that period from 1100 onwards is termed as Anglo-Norman period, and it ranges from 1100 to 1500, and 1500 onwards the period is called as Renaissance period. So the first period, Anglo-Saxon period, is a part of the long medieval period. So let's look at some general background or some general history of that period. So the literature of that period presents or contains a mixed sort of philosophy or mixed sort of ideas, because the English nation, or the three warrior tribes, Angles and Saxons and Jutes, they had come from a bit different places. So their philosophy or their ideas contain German philosophies or ideas, and some Scandinavian ideas as well, because they had come from those places. And also we see a sort of mixture of religion, or the religion was Christianity, and pagans or non-believers. So they, in the literature, we would find different ideas. We would find some religious literature or ideas from religion as well, and some of the literature contains the ideas of non-believers or pagans as well. Or we can call it a mixture of Christianity and heathendom. Again, heathens is the believer of gods and goddesses, who believe in many gods and goddesses, or who do not believe in Christianity. So Christianity believes in one god, whereas the heathens or pagans, they believed in many gods and goddesses, just like the Hindus or just like the Greek people. So Christians were the readers or the followers of Bible, and they had got their inspirations, they had got their content, they had got their themes, their ideas, their philosophies from their holy book, which is the Holy Bible. Whereas the heathens, they believed in many gods and goddesses, they had their own previous history and culture and civilization and philosophy. So the pagan literature, or the literature which contains the elements of heathendom, it is a bit different from Christianity, or the literature which is inspired by the Bible. So the readers of Bible, or the followers of Bible, were mainly from Germany and Scandinavian countries and Italy. So most of the religious literature was because of the influence of religion and because of the influence of churches. Moving on, we would look on some general characteristics of the literature of that period. So in the literature of Anglo-Saxon period, we would find love of nature, we would find love of honor or glory, we would find that the literature of that period has some pessimistic tones as well, or ideas as well, and most of the literature of that period is anonymous. And in some of the literature of that period, we would find details of their ancestral heroes, their gods and goddesses, and the battles they had fought. So Yes, we talk about the love of nature. We would find love of nature in their literature because they lived in a natural environment or a natural surrounding. The times were not developed, the technology was not developed at that time. So most of the people, the tribes, they lived alongside nature, in the lap of nature. So we would find love of nature in their literature. As far as love for honor or glory is considered, these tribes, they were warrior tribes, and these tribes were sort of nomadic tribes. They moved from place to place, they fought many battles, they had to fight for food, they had to fight for their honor. So we would find that they value honor or they value glory. As far as pessimistic tone is concerned, there you would find pessimistic tone in certain poems or literature of that period, because they had to fight with natural calamities or natural disasters, they had to fight with other tribes, they had to fight with animals, etc. So their life was very hard and tough life. They had to face so many fatalities or deaths in battles and in natural disasters, so their tone is a bit pessimistic tone. One of the important characteristics of that the literature of that period is that most of the literature is anonymous, because and anonymous means where there is no know-how of the writer of that period. We do not know who wrote those poems, who was their author, who was the poet, because most of the poems, they were traditional poems, or as generally we say that they were folk songs. So folk songs come from past generations through oral tradition, and they pass from one generation to other generation orally. So we generally do not know who is the author of that poem or that story or that literature. And as they had many ancestral heroes, they had battles, so there must be heroes in those battles. They believed in gods and goddesses, so their poems contain the details of their heroes, their adventures, the battles they had fought, and the gods and their stories as well. Coming to us, poetry. Poetry was the most dominant genre of Anglo-Saxon period, because novel was not invented at that time, drama was not invented at that time in English literature. So all is left is poetry and prose. Prose was also in the phase of beginning or in the phase of development. So poetry, which was a strong genre because of the oral tradition, so poetry is the most dominant genre of that period. And we can divide the poetry of that period into two distinct groups, or we can classify them into two distinct separations. And the first is heathen or pagan poetry, or the poetry of the non-believers, or the poetry of those people who did not believe in Christianity. And then we have religious poetry, poetry which contains ideas or themes or philosophy of religion. And when we say religion, we mean Christianity here. One of the general things about the literature of that period is most of the poetry of that period is lost. We do not have details, we do not have complete poems of that period. But somehow, some 30,000 lines are still preserved in four different manuscripts of that period. Let's look at pagan poetry first. And pagan poetry began, or pagan poetry contains generally the songs of, oral songs of those tribes and their history. So they were warrior tribes. When they sit together at night or at feasts, they sang many songs, and in those songs they celebrated their heroes, they celebrated their gods and goddesses. They narrated the accounts or details of the battles they had fought. So pagan poetry or Anglo-Saxon poetry began in the shape of or in the form of these songs. Let's have a look at some examples. We have a poem, Widsith, and this poem is a descriptive poem. It describes the imaginary visits of a poet to the courts or to the states of different kings. So in this poem, there is a poet and he's wandering, he's going around in different countries and in different courts of various kings, and these visits are imaginative visits. So these contain the details of different states and their kings. We have another poem, Complaint of Dior. And complaint, you all know very well what is a complaint. And Dior means a minstrel or a clown or a court singer or a traveling singer. So this poem contains the story of a traveling singer and his complaints and his worries about his life. And this poem is it is consisted of 42 lines. And in this poem, the singer or the Dior is complaining about his replacement. He says that when he was not there in the court of the king, the king has replaced him with his rival, with his opponent or with his enemy. And he says that I have been serving here for so long and for so many years, but when I was not here, when I was absent, my place has been given to my enemy, and he's complaining about that. The most important poem of Anglo-Saxon period or pagan poetry is Beowulf. And Beowulf is the only complete epic or only complete poem of the period. And second thing about its importance, it is that it contains the details or the histories or references to the great events of those past periods, and the details of the kings and different states and dynasties of the past. So this poem is important because first, it is the only complete epic poem, and secondly, it contains the many historical details of the past kings and their rules and their states and different events that happened in their kingship. So Beowulf is the most important poem of that period or Anglo-Saxon period, and this poem is in two parts. And Beowulf is the story of adventures of Beowulf. Beowulf himself is the hero, and he is the slayer, he is the killer of monsters. And in this story, he would be killing different monsters in different dynasties or states. And the poem is narrated in two parts. And you can study the detail of the story of Beowulf in the notes or material I have provided you on the SIS. Let's talk about religious poetry. Most of the surviving poetry of that period consists of religious poetry. The fact that most of the poems that belong to Anglo-Saxon period are religious poems goes to the care given by the clerks or the monasteries or the religious people. The religious people, they believed in religion, so they preserved these religious poems. Whereas there were no non-believers left later on, so the pagan poetry or non-believer poetry, there was no one to preserve it. So gradually the pagan poetry or the non-believers poetry is lost, whereas the religious poetry was taken care of by clerks and the monasteries and churches. So religious poetry survived. And in the religious poetry, we have two very important and major poets. The first one is Catman. He is one of the religious poets, and the second one is Cenobulf. So these two are the most important religious poets of that period. And when we talk about Catman, what did he write? What sort of poems did he write? So he wrote the whole story of fate of man. He started with the creation of man, creation of Adam and Eve, and he then narrated the story of their fall and getting out of the Eden, and then to the last judgment. So he sang the whole story of Genesis. Genesis is the first book of Old Testament. Old Testament is a book of Bible. Bible has generally two books or two versions. The first one is Old Testament and the other one is New Testament. So Genesis is the name of the first book of Old Testament. And he talked about Exodus of Israelites, the people of Israelites, or in Arabic we say Bani Israel. So they're going out from the city because of the Pharaoh or Pharaoh, and their entrance into the promised land, the coming of holy angel or the coming of Gabriel or Jibreel, the story of Jesus Christ and his crucifixion and his ascension or his going back to the God. So he has written all this story, which we do have in Holy Quran as well, and which is there in the Bible as well. The second most important poet is Kinewulf. His most important poem is the Christ or Christ. And this poem talks about the leading events or the major events of the life of Jesus Christ, Prophet Christ, and his prophethood. Whatever events happened in his prophethood, he talked about all those in his poem, Christ or Christ. So this is all about the poetry of Anglo-Saxon period. Let's move to the prose. So English prose began in this period. So this period is very important for the study of English prose, because English prose had its beginnings in this period. And English prose generally began in the form of the books of history. You can see on the screen the word chronicle. Chronicle means history, the book of history. So English prose began with the chronicle or books of histories, and the people or the writers who were very much famous or who were very important for beginning to write history in English were King Alfred and his court, the people of his court. So it began in King Alfred's time. King Alfred the Great, he himself translated many books of history from Latin language into English language, and he also encouraged these translations. So he began the translations, and he is the most important person for beginning of English prose. And we have another person important for the beginnings, and he is Ealfric. Ealfric was a priest, and when he used to give sermons, when he used to give his sermons in the church, he used a form of poetic prose, and his poetic prose is preserved, and that poetic prose is also a part of the prose or the part of the literature of Anglo-Saxon period. So Anglo-Saxon period, it contains poetry, and it contains the beginnings of the English prose. Thank you very much. If you have questions, you can ask me on the WhatsApp group, which has been formed by the officials. And if you have questions, you can ask me via email as well. Thank you.